Welcome to Tanakh Talk. I'm your host, William Hall, broadcasting to you live out of Kingsland, Texas, USA, with episode number 22 of Rabbi Tovia Singer's Let's Get Biblical Q&A. We've got a little juicy topic for this week, the Kaduri Conundrum. Coming to you live from Jakarta, Indonesia, is our beloved Rabbi Tovia Singer, who has many things available to you that you guys can check into at his website. He's got the two-book volume set with the CDs that go with it, as well as some other fun stuff. So be sure to check out his website sooner or later. So without further ado, I want to bring to you and present to you our beloved Rabbi Tovia Singer. Shalom, shalom, pleasure. Rabbi. How are you?
Shalom, my friend. It's a big pleasure to have me on the show. We're ready to rock and roll.
Yes, we are. Yes, we are. Wow.
And I'm back from Papua. I'm back from the largest island in Indonesia, teaching Torah. Many people came to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob over the last week. Messianic leaders. I'll let them speak for themselves.
Interesting.
But it's been very, very exciting. Absolutely.
Rabbi, the pictures you've had on Facebook recently with the miners, what is all that about?
There's a part of Papua. It's called Freeport, and it's a mountain of gold. That's all I can say. It's the largest gold deposit of any place in the world, in the hot. The highest quality gold. I'll put out photographs so you can see it.
I'd prefer you send me samples if that's cool.
Yeah. With you. Oh, you actually want the gold. Okay. So I have a lot of security there. But the key is that yes. I've been to Papua teaching Torah many times, and there are many, many people there who are descendants of Jews from Peru. Papua is the largest island in Indonesia. Indonesia is a country of 17,000 islands. Papua has a distinct a population that is racially distinct, different than Java, where I'm at. I'm in Jakarta, the Indonesia's capital. And these people fled South America, ultimately fleeing the Catholic Church centuries ago, only to come to Papua and eventually assimilate into the church, got caught up in the Messianic movement, and with the help of Hashem, with his hand, I was fortunate enough to go there and teach Torah, and whole churches just turned to synagogues. That's all I could tell you.
Wow.
So the miners asked me to go up on the mountain. And when I say mountain, I'm not talking about the Catskills. I'm not talking about the Rockies. I'm talking about went up to a mountain where it was hard to breathe. We were about somewhere around 14,000 feet up in the mountain. And that's where we started. We prayed together and studied Torah together on the top of the mountain. And miners came who were out, you know, digging gold, and they all came and took off, and we prayed. It was just something I can't describe. There are pictures up of it, but I don't know what to say. It's just Hashem. I don't know what to say. But they're coming home.
Yeah.
That's like God made a promise. He made a promise in Isaiah 43 that I will bring your daughters home. I'll bring your sons home from the furthest islands, from the corners of the earth. Read Isaiah 43 verse 6. And I have news for you, my brothers and sisters. God has kept his promise. That's all I can tell you. The God of Israel kept his promise, and that he would see fit, that he would use me as a vessel in some way. You know, they're like thanking me, and I'm going, what are you thanking me? Like, I grew up in New York. I grew up in Yeshiva. I grew up, you know, you're like nowhere in the middle of Papua, you know, and you just want, even though it's so hard to get a kosher piece of meat, it's hard to get, you know, it's difficult. These people, they don't care. They want more Torah. They want to know how to live their lives. Last night, one of the leaders of the Messianic movement in Indonesia repented and returned back to the God of Israel, and now he's going to turn to his congregation to do the same. I know if I say, I usually don't talk this way because it's really about the Bible, but something is happening, and that is that God has kept his promise. These people rightfully should be completely lost among the nations. They should be gone. There is no natural force that would dictate that a people in the extreme corner of Southeast Asia, only 4 degrees off the equator, that on a mountaintop, that these people should come to Torah and embrace the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They should rightfully have been lost, but we have a God, and we have a God who made a promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and God has redeemed them from slavery, from bondage, and has brought them home. That's all I can tell you. He has kept his promise, and I saw it with my eyes. I can't begin to tell you about Freeport. You can Google it, whatever you want to do. But it's we're talking about a mountain of gold. I mean, literally, you walk by, and I didn't have time to put up pictures, but you literally, the rocks there are just gold. I mean, it's gold mixed with rock, but you just, it glimmers. It's like you're in a movie set. It's not, nothing is real, but this is unbelievable. I mean, just unbelievable where we were. And I'll tell you this. The stuff we learned in school about, like, the higher you go, the thinner the air gets. I've never been 14,000 feet up. I've just never been. I have in a plane, a pressurized plane. I actually had, in order to do this, I had to go to the doctor and actually get certified, you know, to take all your vitals that you're fit to actually go to the top of the mountain. And I passed with flying colors. And, you know, I was taken up to the top. And when I realized when I got there why. If you're standing still at 14,000 feet or something around there, you don't have to even walk. You're breathing very heavy. The air, the oxygen is really, the air is thin, the oxygen is thin. Whatever it is, people have come to the God of Israel. That's all I can tell you.
That's a beautiful.
That's it. I can't, this is it. This is the last corner of the world where really the Jewish people haven't really been here. We have, but not reaching out to the people. We are now, and they're coming home. They just, all they want to do is they want to see the Bible. It's all about scripture.
That's awesome.
And the Messianic leader last night said, you know, all you did here, I've watched you, is talk about the Bible, not about yourself. You didn't walk around praising and blessing and all that stuff. You just talked scripture. And he said that's why he repented. And that's the head of the major Messianic whole synod in Indonesia, and he repented right there. In front of the whole, I mean, I can't, I did a whole seminar just for pastor. What can I say? There's nothing else to say. God has kept his promise. The God of Israel does not sleep. He does not slumber. I am, I will be the one that I will be. I will always keep my word. And he has. And I see it with my eyes. And if I didn't see it, and if I was just hearing it, I don't know if I mean, I guess, you know, you can see it on my Facebook and so on. People are putting up the photos and people are giving their, are testifying to their repentance, and the numbers are astounding. But if I didn't see it, I don't know if I would fully, I'm floating. I just flew in today to Jakarta. It's a big distance, by the way. Flying from Papua to Jakarta is basically the same distance as flying from Los Angeles to New York. It's it's a big country here with almost the same size population. I'm going to move the camera back just a drop. The same size population as the United States. That's all. There's nothing else I can say. I can't. You know.
That's awesome.
That's all. You know. Ainu Daima Shmiler. I love Hashem and I love Scripture, but you know, when you see it yourself, just like when the children of Israel saw the miracle years, centuries earlier to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They were moved by Aminu Bashem Moshe Avdo. They saw God's name. They pointed their finger and said, "Zek Keli Vianveyu, this is my God, and I will beautify him." They said that with one voice, and what has happened. I have seen the wonders and the miracles. I've seen prophecy before my eyes, and you know, that's all I could say. But it's only that Hashem's name is raised up. I didn't, all I did was teach scripture. It's Hashem's name that was raised up above every other name. Do not go around saying, "Oh, Tovia, you're this, that." A lot of people do that. It makes me feel good a little bit, but it really isn't. All I did was just answer their questions and teach Tanakh. That's it. Okay, so that's the whole deal. There's not false humility. I did nothing fancy goes on.
And that's exactly why we have you here today, Lord. Rabbi. No, you're right.
Listen, no, you don't have to call me these fancy names and fancy titles.
Yeah.
You could just call me King of the Jews, and that's close enough, and that's fine.
Of course. You know, you said something earlier. We've got a call with David. David's on the phone with us. We're going to get to him in just 1 second. You said something earlier about this rabbi, this messianic rabbi who repented. One of the questions we're going to come into, we're going to get to the Kaduri conundrum shortly, but I want to take care of a few things first. This question that's coming off of what you spun with the repentant messianic rabbi was, in the Christian circles, is it possible for a person in the church to really, really have this emotional repentant experience, but then remain in the church? We're going to kind of get to that. There's other aspects of that we're going to talk about, but that's a very intriguing question. So, well, for now, let's get with David from Ocean Park is on the phone. Good morning to you, David. How are you? Hello, can you hear us now? I got you cranked way up.
You're cranked.
Let me make sure I got my speed. I hope I don't blast us out of the studio. I hear him, but it's very faint. I think I'm using my wife's computer, so I may have to go and change the setting on here. David, call us back in, give us 10 minutes or so. I'm gonna change the setting here in a few minutes. So, and for all you viewers out there, when you call in 855-952-4253, 855-95-BIBLE, just I'll answer the call, but then I'm gonna turn the volume down so you'll listen to us talk. We will not forget about you, so just hang in there. It may take 20 minutes, but you're gonna watch the program anyway. You might as well listen to it live. So call in whenever you're ready. Okay, so Rabbi, while we're waiting for David to call back, just real quickly, since it's so fresh on topic, this messianic rabbi repented. What does that mean in the church whenever someone repents or when they have these emotional experiences and it's a legitimate, genuine, I feel terrible about what I did, but is that even repentant from sin or is that just repentance from their own moral behavior? Does that make sense?
No, first of all, let me just explain this. Last night, for example, we had Shabbat together. We had the third meal together. We prayed together. We completed the Shabbat together. I was in a room with many, many, many former Messianic leaders because I've been back and forth to Papua constantly. There are so many former Messianic leaders in my life. I know more Messianic leaders than the head of the head of Jews for Jesus. When I say repented, what they did was they realized that they had been worshiping a man as God, that they haven't been following the God of Israel. And, you know, bear in mind that, you know, many of these people are very, very sincere. Many of the people in the Messianic movement, particularly the followers. I mean, I'll just say this to you. I don't know if I haven't done a study of this, but my anecdotal experience has been, and it's a lot of experience, it's about 30 years in this work, more than that, is that the people in the congregations are very sincere. I have generally not been impressed with the Messianic leaders. I have met, it's very rare that I met Messianic leaders who I was struck by their sincerity. And but the followers are sincere. I find that in churches, the people who genuinely really believe this and are not up to any kind of games are not the pastors, are not the messianic rabbis, but that the people in the pews. That's what I find. Now, that said, in Indonesia, things are a little different. In Indonesia, the churches picked up on the Messianic movement in the West, but they're not really doing it to convert Jews. They like to, but that's not their purpose. They just want something more Jewishy, right? But they don't know anything. They don't have access to Torah in Indonesia. And I should explain why they don't have access. And that is that, as it turns out, a great number of Indonesians are not bilingual. It's unfortunate, but the vast majority of Indonesians that I've met do not speak English, do not understand English. I have an interpreter wherever I go. I travel with a number of interpreters. Now, one other point is no other country besides Malaysia speaks Indonesian. Malay and Indonesian are virtually identical. So the point is, if you are an Indonesian and that's all the only language you speak, that means you have no access to art scroll. You have no access to studying, to understanding my lectures. You have no access to that. So they're really very cut off. It's not like someone who's in the Messianic movement in Chicago that can listen to my lectures, that can study online on YouTube and listen to wonderful rabbis all over the world teaching Torah. These people don't have that kind of access because what happens is there's a barrier for them. It's a language barrier. It's really unfortunate here in Indonesia that few Indonesians speak English fluently, very, very few. That's a problem. And therefore, those who are filled with the Messianic movement in Indonesia can't read my book. They can't listen to my lectures. So they need me there with the interpreter there. But this is like their first opportunity in their lives. So I don't hold them accountable. I know why they'd be lost in the church. And basically, if all I knew is what they're teaching, and I couldn't read Hebrew, and I was reading the Christian Bible and reading the few passages in Jewish scriptures that have been altered by translations, I don't know what I would do. That's what's going on. They are kind of fenced in, I want to make that point, by a language. And this is a problem for Indonesians in general. They don't have access to English media, they don't have access to they have very limited access, so that's why my work here is very, very important. They can't, if you're from Singapore, well, the people in Singapore speak English fluently. But in Indonesia, it's only kind of the elite that speak English really well. The intellectual elite, those who've gone to university in Australia, or those but generally, it's just, for whatever reason, in English is not widely spoken here. I mean, you can get along, but it's I want that to change in this country because it's a problem for them. They can't, it's hard for them to study Torah. If you only speak Indonesian, but that's the deal. So,
okay. All right. Very good. So in summary, like for example, with people who have these moments in the church, I mean, doesn't the mere definition of repentance reflect the actual sin, repent from sin? Which is,
Teshuvah in Hebrew comes from the word tashuv, which means shuv, which means to return. It just literally means to turn to God, to turn to your true lover, turn to your true husband, to turn to your true father, and to put away everything that's unclean, to wash yourself, to rise up. That's what it means. So teshuvah means one who has turned. That's what the word teshuv. The word shuv means return. Teshuvah is a noun instead of a verb. It is the act of turning to the God of Israel.
Gotcha. And so, like, I was thinking of something whenever you were talking, and I was picturing like my son. Let's say he was, running through the house with muddy shoes, and he was, tearing up things along the way. And all he saw was that I was upset with his actions. And all he did was say, "I'm sorry, I'm sorry," because he felt so bad he made me angry. But he didn't actually find out what it was that was making me angry. And so for him to say, "I'm sorry," and I really have this heartfelt, like, "Oh my God, I hurt daddy's feelings." That's kind of where I'm curious and maybe confused a little bit.
They don't know here. Right. They really don't. They really don't know. And it's true for folks in the Messianic movement. It's true for folks in the church. They really don't know. Mm-hmm. They have no idea. And the Messianic movement, this might come as a surprise to most folks, is very anti-Jewish. Now, I don't mean anti-Jewish culturally or anti-Israel, but they really detest and they express the most odious things about rabbis, about Judaism, traditional Judaism. I have not been exposed personally to a single pastor, a non-Jewish pastor from a Baptist church or an Assemblies of God church. I've met many of them who are as disrespectful to Jewish people and the Jewish faith as are folks in the Messianic movement. They just, I'm not speaking to like yeshiva students right now. because you have been in the church and the Messianic movement. You've spoken about this, and most of our listeners probably have. So I'm not talking to people who don't know. In reality, if you I don't mean a mainline. Evangelical Christians have a great deal of respect for rabbis and for the Jewish people and Jewish faith and love Israel. And I've not heard a bad word out of their mouth. Mm-hmm. But in the Messianic movement, that's where you're going to hear, you know, where Jews are being persecuted, the rabbis are lying, this kind of invective. It comes from the Messianic movement, and they actually poison churches.
Right.
I know this is counterintuitive. They actually will go into Prestwood Baptist Church in Dallas, mm-hmm. Texas, a huge church, and a Messianic leader will get in there and talk about how he's being persecuted for Yeshua in Israel. We need more money because we're trying to spread the word, but we're being persecuted by the rabbis, by the Jews. And these nice Baptists are listening to this and going, really? Jews are doing this stuff? So this the negativity comes from the Messianic movement, not from...
Yeah.
Ordinary, and everyone knows what I'm saying is accurate.
I have seen this myself, and I was in the Messianic business for like 5 years or so.
Yeah.
So,
my audience are folks who are from the church mm-hmm. and from the Messianic movement,
mm-hmm.
And everyone knows I'm saying it the way it is.
Sure,
you know? I'm not saying every pastor is in love with Jews. Or I'm not saying that. Just my experience is
sure. The
greatest respect it's not just when we're looking. The people I've debated, they're just people who speak honorably about the Jewish people and the Jewish faith. Doesn't mean they believe in the Jewish faith. They are Christians. But when you bring down Jews for Jesus, boy, you're dealing with folks who they are tearing up the mm-hmm. place. But anyways, I just want to make this point. This is not why someone should reject the teachings of the church or embrace it.
Right.
That means it could be there's a bunch of bad Messianic folks out there that has nothing to do with whether Jesus is the Messiah or not. That's irrelevant to it. The only thing that really is real, the only thing that's real is the Bible. So I want to be very careful. I do not want folks who are listening or watching the show right now, I do not want you to accept or reject the teaching of the church because Messianic leaders don't behave well.
Right.
That's wrong. That is not relevant. Only thing that is real, and there's one thing, and that's the Bible. And that's what I'm always going to reach to so that we can find out what is God's opinion. This mm-hmm. is not whether they're good Christians or bad Christians, but what does Scripture say, period. And it's what does Scripture say graphically, mm-hmm. clearly. Okay,
indeed.
So I just want to make that point.
Very good. Okay, we've got a caller. Caller, welcome to Tanakh Talk. Can you hear us okay? Okay, hello. If you can hear us, go ahead and turn down your computer device that you're listening in on.
Oh, okay.
If you don't mind, it'll just kind of cut down the feedback. And so what we're going to do too, we're going to take your question, and once we have it verified that everybody's on the same page, we'll disconnect and open up the phone lines. Okay.
Okay. It does sound kind of funny. It does sound kind of funny. Like there's an echo.
Okay. It's probably, I don't hear an echo on our end. And if you're still hearing it on yours, it may be because you've got the device somewhere in the background playing. That's okay though. We can hear you really loud and clear. What is your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Alonso Echavarria.
Welcome to the broadcast. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Big Spring, Texas.
Big Spring. I have been there. That was a terrible drive. I thought it was going to be an hour. It took me four.
Yeah.
Very good. What is your question for the rabbi today?
Well, first, I want to say that I want to thank Rabbi Zinger for all the videos he has posted online. I've been watching them, and it's been really a great awakening. It's amazing. And I want to congratulate him on his comedian stand when he went to Houston Baptist University. It was really funny delivery. It was great, very entertaining.
Yeah.
Thank you. It was a great experience.
Rabbi, I got the impression that because, and I'm sure that Alon is going to agree with this, that the guy had so many things for you to respond to at you had such little time to get it in. You were just like getting it out there so fast, and only the people who are quick tongued and quick witty could actually follow along with you. But it was definitely a one way.
I was very fine because I knew it was filmed, so mm-hmm. I knew that if people would not be able to catch every point, they'd be able to watch it again on YouTube, and 20,000 people have in just since we've done the program. So yeah, that's fine. But thank you. I'm glad you enjoyed it. I had a wonderful time, and I look forward to doing that again. What's on your mind?
Alon, can you hear okay?
Yeah, I can hear you now. I do have a question regarding Noachides.
Sure.
What is the responsibility that we Noachides have to the Torah? Hmm.
What responsibility does a Noachide have to the Torah? So a Noachide for those who don't know, is someone who is not Jewish, although. And thank you for your call.
Yeah, thank you, Alon. And tune into the, if you turn your broadcast back on, it's probably about a 30-second delay, okay?
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.
All right. Bless
okay,
you.
Rabbi, go ahead.
So a Noachide means a person who, Noachide, some people might go, what's a Noachide? Well, as it turns out, the Noachide movement, one might say, is the oldest religion in the world. I mean, that's what the children of Noah are, those who believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And for Noachides, to the best of their knowledge, they're not Jewish. I say that in that manner because, as it turns out over the years, I have just met so many people who all their lives identified as, they thought they weren't Jewish. Something pulled them to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to the Jewish faith. In almost all cases, these are people who left the church rather than leaving a Hindu temple, typically, and they embrace the Jewish faith, and therefore the mitzvos of the Torah, the 613 commandments of the Torah, are incumbent upon the Jewish people. A point should be made, and that is that the vast majority of those 613 commandments, if you don't live in the land of Israel in our time, don't apply. About 280 of them do apply right now. Most of them have to do with the land of Israel, with the temple, and so on and so forth. A person who is a child of God, who embraces the God of Israel, they have approximately 70 commandments, which are broken down into seven categories. And these are the seven, called seven Noachide laws. I'm reluctant to use that term because typically people believe that means that there are only seven commandments, but it's really seven categories of commandments. And those commandments are, you know, people go, well, how do I know there are these commandments? There are people actually ask me that question, and I'm going, they're right there in the Bible, and that is to worship the God of Israel alone and no other, not to commit an act of blasphemy, not to worship any other god but the God of Israel, to live morally, not like animals, but like those who are created in the image of God, because every human being has a neshama, has a soul, a chelak mimal mamish, which means a part of divinity that has been infused into his or her nostrils. And God is within a spark of the Almighty that can never be destroyed, is in each and every person. And therefore, God calls upon every human being to live by commandments. That means not to steal, not to murder. You may go, what do you, well, of course not steal, not murder. Well, the cat you have, the dog you have, they commit murder, they rape, they commit infanticide each and every day. And to them, there's nothing wrong with it. They don't even know what you're talking. You couldn't explain to a dog or even a monkey or a dolphin, very intelligent mammals, they have no clue what you're talking about. You can teach them, but they're not created in the image of God. So therefore, the Noachide has seven commandments, which include to not to murder, not to steal, to to live an ethical, moral life, not to engage in relationships that are forbidden. There are actually 19 forbidden relationships for Noachide. What is very important for the Noachide also is to, when the Noachide is honest in business, if you're listening to the show and you're a Noachide and you own a business, and when it comes time for you to pay your employees, it's very important to pay them on time. It's a very big mitzvah, and it is a great sin to withhold an employee's pay. In fact, the book of Malachi indicates that that kind of behavior is what holds back the Messianic age. But it's very important for Noachai to recognize that they're keeping these commandments not because their intelligence tells them so, not because it makes sense to them just because it, you know, I don't want to steal. No. To say that I'm honest in business, I live a moral life because the God of Israel commanded me. This is very important. And that's why it's in a way more difficult to be a Noachide than a Jew, because a Jew has many additional commandments that cannot be understood in any other way except that God commanded us. When we keep the Sabbath, which a Jew is... which was given to the Jewish people in Exodus 31. Shabbos is Beini Uvein Bnei Israel, between God and Israel. It's an eternal covenant. Well, when a Jew makes Kiddush, you know, meaning sanctifies the Sabbath, there's no other way for us to interpret that that behavior except that we're doing it for God. But Noachide has to be mindful that you are creating the image of Hashem. And therefore, that's why you're keeping these commandments. And a Noachide has a place in the world to come. A Noachide is a person who is beloved by God. And Abraham was not Jewish. I have news for you. He was a Noachide. And he came to love the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He grew up in a home of idolatry. And he rejected it. And he chose the God of Israel. And so that's what's incumbent upon a Noachide. Now, a Noachide is free, not only free to, a Noachide certainly, when it comes to a Jewish holiday, many Noachides say, I just want to rejoice over Shabbat. Please do. I want to rejoice over Passover and thank God that the Almighty kept his promise and redeemed the children of Israel, kept his promise and brought us from the ashes of the Holocaust through Jacob's trouble and brought us the children of Israel back to land. Certainly, Noachides are welcome to do that, but there are seven categories of laws that is incumbent upon a Noachide, but the Noachide must recognize that they're keeping these laws because God commanded them and because they're created in the image of God. I'll say one other point that I think needs to be expressed. This is a little tricky, but the Jews did not receive the Torah and go, wow, you can't murder, who would know? This is a very important point. I mean, you can't murder, you can't rape your sister. What? Wow, that's weird. Okay, that didn't happen. Because we are created in the image of God, our soul, our neshama, our being our voltage is matched to God. It makes sense to us. When we see abominations, it hurts our soul. So because we're creating the image of God, so therefore it works, it fits. So when you say, well, I find someone who murders to be repulsive, someone who steals to be someone who is doing something abhorrent, recognize that your cat or your dog that you love doesn't even know what you're talking about. Your dog will take another dog's food without even blinking. They don't even know what you're talking about. So the key is to recognize that our awareness comes from God, and that's what's important for Noachide. And that's a great challenge to the Noachides. But the whole Messianic age is about the Gentiles, or those who are not part of the nation of Israel, coming and cleaving to the children of Israel. Awesome. So that's my answer, okay?
Very good. I'm glad you covered the Holy Day part too, because that was something that that everybody's always curious about. Hey, Rabbi, do you have a way to pull up an email, a chance from where you're at? Have you got a screen available for that?
I could. It would just take a moment. No, I don't have it open.
Would, because here in a few minutes, when we do get to this point, I'm going to have you pull open and actually view something that I'm going to have on the screen. And since you don't have me on your screen, you won't see it through my window. So, it's basically one of the copies of the Kaduri letters, and that way you can kind of look at it and just kind of feel it out as you're talking to us about it. So, and for the callers, again, I just had another call. They hung in for, you know, a good 8 seconds at least, but just stay on the phone if you want to talk to the rabbi. Like I said, I'll answer the call, but we're just going to kind of turn it down, and as soon as we're ready for you, you know what? That's probably the same caller. So let's answer this and see what we got. Oh, this is David. Hello, David. How are you, sir? David, do me a favor. Turn your device down. Another caller I had it up, and we could actually hear him better once he turned it down. You may already know this. Okay, tested. Can you hear me now? Okay, David. Oh, yeah. Now I can hear you. Can you hear me okay?
There's tremendous distortion again.
Okay, we had a caller a minute ago that
it goes on and off.
Interesting. Are you talking about where?
I'm speaking on a landline.
Okay, so you're hearing
if
distortion.
You can hear me, but allow me to ask the question.
Yes.
Okay. First of all, with a smile and to a friend, William, I'm going to give a little update. Hello, Rabbi. I'm sure that you gave a report shalamah to Rabbi Kaduri. Now, William, the last two times I called, you know, I usually ask the last two times the same question. You said to Rabbi, do you want to answer this or should I put on another call? I'm the one that called. I'm not answering. So this is the question. Same question. My dilemma with basically teach in the temple or not. Did he teach the Pharisees or not? Did he throw over the table? Was he permitted or not? Was he a rabbi?
Ah.
Did Josephus write about him? As far as Josephus only had one line, and it wasn't even him, about his brother. And that's about it. I won't go over
the okay, you did good. There is a bad connection. I'm going to have to, I think I know what you asked the question. Now, Rabbi, were you able to piece that together?
No.
Okay. In the New Testament, was Jesus a rabbi? Did he teach the Pharisees? Did he turn over the temples? No.
William, not the New Testament. Under our
understanding. Okay. Okay. Not according to the New Testament, but according to Judaism.
Okay.
I can't hear you, but you got it. Can I head up?
Yes, sir. Go right ahead. We'll talk to you soon. Thank you. Okay, so according to Judaism, according to even with Josephus, you know, because there's very little recorded about Jesus by Josephus, from what I understand. But according to Judaism, was this Jesus person who was a historical figure? Was he indeed a rabbi? Was he a righteous person, or was he like a heretic? I mean, that's kind of the feel I was getting. And are there sources in Judaism that would point one way or the other?
Okay, this is a difficult topic, only because whereas I can only say, you know, black, white, very clear, this is a little controversial. One thing that isn't controversial is there are no contemporaneous writers, Christian or Jewish, contemporaneous of Jesus, who wrote one word about him. So I just want to make that clear. Jesus didn't write anything. If he did, it didn't survive. Okay? We don't have it. No Christian claims to have it, except for a letter in the sand. And actually, that's a later interpolation in the book of John. So there is zero that is contemporaneous. That is not disputed by anyone. There is no, the earliest Christian source we have is the year 50 or maybe 49 from 1 Thessalonians. So that would be a Christian source. Josephus is a forgery. meaning that we, in the War of the Jews, we have nothing about Josephus, from written by Josephus in, let's say, 73, 74, nothing. But we do have an interpolation in Antiquities of the Jews, which means there is what's called TF, and that's in Antiquities of the Jews. Antiquities of the Jews is a very large work written by Josephus in the year 94. Now, remember, Josephus did not live when Jesus was alive. And I'm just presuming that, I'm just using, most Christians would say Jesus was born around 6 BCE, was died around 30. So I'm just going to accept that. You know, I'm not going to speculate about that. Josephus was born in a very important year. He was born in the year 37. He was born the same year that Pontius Pilate was removed from authority. He was born the same year of that Octavius's reign, Caesar Augustus, came to an end. So he's born long after the fact. Now, what we do have in Antiquities of the Jews, in specifically in Book 18, Section 3, Paragraph 3, is a later interpolation about Jesus. I mean, Josephus didn't write about Jesus, but the church scribes in the first century, and we're pretty sure who did this, inserted this whole text. We're having Josephus, and the churches did a lot of that. They played with texts. They played with their own Bible. There were forgeries like the Gospel of Peter, which wasn't written by Peter, all this stuff. So the church had no problem about making stuff up. They did it to their own Bible. They added in the Joannian Common, 1 John 5, 7, and 8, which is the doctrine of the Trinity, and every Christian knows that's a forgery put into the Christian Bible and still appears in King James Bibles. Well, if they did it to their own Bible, they certainly would do it to Josephus, and they did. And there, if you open up any Josephus, you can, it's free online, you'll see there was a man named Jesus, if one can call him a man, and he was the Christ, and he did many great wonders and works and so on and so forth. Well, Josephus wasn't a Christian, so this is a later interpolation. We are pretty sure who did this. We know when it was done, and that's in about the year 324. And it was almost certainly done by Irenaeus, who was a, Eusebius, excuse me, who was the very well-known church historian. And the reason we can be fairly certain it was him, but it was at that time, this is around Nicaea, is because there are a whole bunch of church fathers prior, that's what's called Antinician church fathers, who lived prior to the Council of Nicaea, who quoted Josephus up and down, and none of them quote this passage. This passage doesn't exist anywhere in Justin. Justin quoted Josephus. That's a second century church father. Origen is a third century church father, a genius. The guy quoted Josephus all over the place, nothing. And they would have loved such a reading because they were defending the Christian religion. These were Christian apologists. So they would have loved such a reading. And in fact, Origen says in his commentary on the book of Matthew in chapter 10, he says Josephus was not a Christian. Origen says that. Now, if Origen read Josephus saying that Jesus was the Messiah, and if you can even call him a man, he wouldn't have said Josephus isn't the Christian. He would have quoted this in his many arguments with pagans who were very anti-Christian. So Josephus doesn't discuss Jesus. That's added in later. It's a forgery. It's inserted into the text. And I counted 12 church fathers. Someone told me 14. I couldn't find 14. But I've counted 12 church fathers prior to Eusebius, who's the historian of the church in the fourth century. None of them mention this. It just isn't there. Now, what has happened is, so for those who are looking this up, is, so 50 years ago, almost every scholar would say it's a complete forgery. Now there's sort of an ecumenical wind in the air among Christian scholars or scholars of the ancient world, and they're saying, look, we could put together a text that Josephus could have written, which would have been a skeletal text, and therefore, although Josephus didn't say all these things, some say he could have said something like there was a guy named Jesus who could have been, but we don't have such a text. That was just a vote, and it's just an ecumenical thing of saying, look, Josephus could have said that without being a Christian. But in fact, Josephus wrote copiously. He wrote, if someone was significant, he went on for chapters. Mm. This is all nonsense. So no, we don't have just, now what we do have is the Talmud. We have Talmudic literature. That's very late, relatively speaking. We're talking about the Talmud is completed around the year 600. And the texts that speak about a Jesus, the problem is that the Jesus, this was a common name. Yeshua or Yeshu would have been a very common name in the ancient world. There are actually 27 people with the name Jesus in Josephus. I have nothing to do with the Jesus of Christianity. Hmm. This was a common name. So I know people, you know, just the way Jesus is very common in Major League Baseball, you know, it's just a popular name. The Jesus that is in the Talmud appears to be somebody, if the dating is right, let's say he lived during the time of Rabbi Yeshua ben Parachia. You may not know who that is, but that's a rabbi who lived about 100 BCE. That means 100 years before the fact. And in fact, so therefore, the texts that it is speculated are about Jesus would place Jesus at a completely different time than Christianity would. And in fact, because of that, it has fed the mythicists, those who claim that Jesus never even existed, and it was a composite personality. But certainly, we don't have anything that anyone says that he was a rabbi, meaning he had smicha. That means that's, rabbi is not like just rabbis, like, you know, you can tell if a chicken's kosher. That means you had the smicha, the ordination from Moses, that you could have been on the Sanhedrin. There is no record of anyone like that. So no, of course not. We have nothing like that. The texts we have are disputed. It has long been argued that this is not the same Jesus of Christianity. There are some scholars who say that it is the Jesus of Christianity, but the Jews were very afraid that they would be persecuted for having a text about Jesus. And these texts about Jesus, incidentally, present him in very negative light. A person who, for example, sees a woman coming out of an inn, a hotel. He is walking with a rabbi, and he makes a remark that something about her eyes, that her eyes are sort of narrow, and just a very unpleasant remark about a woman that they happen upon, and he is rebuked by a rabbi, a fairly famous rabbi. That would place him in a different period. But there are some who believe that, look, this may be complicated, but the Talmud was basically fully edited around the year 600 CE. Okay, now in the year 600, thereabout, Christianity had not yet reached Babylon. So Amoraim, these are the rabbis in Babylon in the 6th century, in the beginning of the 7th century, they would have no concern about Christianity. So they may have explained that there was a person who had, not the worst guy that ever lived, but had some character flaws. And then what subsequently occurred was the Jews were petrified because Talmuds were being burned, synagogues were being burned down, Jews being murdered later on in Europe, in Western Europe, not in the East. And then the Jews then censored their own text because they just didn't want to get killed. So there are some scholars who believe that. None of these texts say that he was a rabbi, no.
Okay, gotcha. Gotcha.
This is a speculative area, but I don't know how far we'll go. It's a speculative topic. But in the 13th century, when the Talmud was put on trial in 1242, there was a Jew who became a Karaite and eventually converted to Christianity, a Jew from Paris. His name was Nicholas Donnan. And he went to Pope Gregory the Ninth and presented serious charges against the Talmud, saying that the Talmud had expressed horrible blasphemy against Jesus and Mary, and therefore the Talmud should be destroyed. And ultimately they were burned. Mm-hmm. The defense in France in 1242, it was a kangaroo court, they didn't have a chance, was that this is not the same person. So the speculation is, knowing full well that if they'd say, yes, this is the Jesus of Christianity, every Jew in France would have been murdered, they might have just said that so that the Jews would not be killed by the church. Mm. That's possible. You know, I couldn't tell you, but that's, you know, that this. So, no, we don't have any text that Jesus was a rabbi. There's nothing like that.
Gotcha. www.outreachjudaism.org. That's where you're going to find all the juicy stuff covering all of the issues of the New Testament versus the prophets in the Old Testament, the full of Tanakh. If you got volume one, if you've got the original one, you need to give that away to somebody, pick up volume one and two, grab the CDs to go with it. A rabbi said you can just listen to them online if you can't purchase them, but you definitely do want to listen to these audio portions to go with this, because they do go hand in hand, and it'll make your absorption of this book so much easier. And so, and along with that, there's other things there. There's the debate that he's got, the Book of Chronicles, fascinating facts of the Book of Chronicles. Even he's got some of the disputation copies there you can get from his website if you like. So be sure to tune in every week. If this is your first time, Rabbi Singer's all over the place. He's got Tovia Singer. Is it toviasinger.tv, Rabbi? Is that how that is?
No, it's just toviasinger.tv.
Okay. And so that's all you can eat buffet if you want to look at it that way. So hey, Rabbi, were you able to pull up that email yet?
No, if
you're willing to do that, that would be great. I'm going to put up a letter here in a minute. Let's go ahead and roll into it's coming up on the hour right now, so it might be a good time to go ahead and hit the hot topic for the day. We did cover this before in pretty good detail, but it kind of got mixed into the middle of a broadcast, and just like this one is, but at least this one, the attention is drawn. There's a lot of curious people who actually wanted to hear this answer, who haven't heard it before. So, Rabbi, you got some fresh ears out here who've not heard a response upon this, upon all the claims about Rabbi Kaduri. So, supposedly, he was 100 plus years old, and he had a letter. And in this letter, well, the letter said, don't open until after I'm dead, or whatever the case may be. And when they opened the letter up, it supposedly proclaimed that Yeshua was indeed the Messiah. And you know, Rabbi, the very first thing that comes to my mind on this whole thing, one of the things that I've always been taught in the Christian church is where Jesus says, if you are ashamed of me, then I will be ashamed of you before my Father in heaven. So if he really found out that this was, that Yeshua was the Messiah, him not telling anybody pretty much got him condemned. I mean, according to that concept, because he says, if you are ashamed of me, then I'll be ashamed of you before my Father who's in heaven. That's kind of the New Testament reference. So the whole thing reeks of falsehood to begin with. Rabbi, I'm going to turn this over to you. I'm going to put up a picture of this letter. And when you open it, I sent you all three of them. I've only got two of them that I'm going to show. One of them actually has like highlighted red marks. I'm going to pull it up now. Highlighted red marks along the letter. On certain things for, and I don't know if, whose side that's on, but they're there nonetheless. And the other one is a larger square document with Hebrew writing at the bottom. So I'm not sure which one, you can grab a hold of first, but I sent that to you just so you can kind of look at it as you're talking. And if you see something that jumps off the page or, is it looks like it's upside down? No. That's funny. One of the letters actually looks like it's upside down. Anyway, okay, Rabbi, so I'm going to let this go with you now and let you kind of let everybody know. And also, hey, as you're going, the other guy who's got the video, the guy with the long beard, and he's the very first thing he's talking about is how you've got to shave your eyebrows. I don't know. It was all kinds of stuff that he was saying, that you had to do. He found out that using Isaiah 53, that Jesus was the Messiah too. You mentioned about that too, and I really would like for you to include that in your talk today on this topic.
Sure, it's hard to know where to begin. I want to, first of all, for the missionaries who are watching this show, for Christians who are interested in converting Jews to Christianity, I want to give you some really good advice, and that is, if you want to convert Jews to Christianity, it's there really is one thing you need to do that's really fairly simple, And I think it would have a very big impact on me. I know it would have a very big impact on William Hall, the host of this show, and it would have a very big impact on thousands of Jews worldwide. And that is, if you open the Jewish scriptures, Tanakh, which is a large corpus of sacred literature, more than 23,000 verses, so you have a lot of areas to work in, and you can find passages like you would find in the book of John. So if you have John 17:3, if you can find that in the book of Deuteronomy, I guarantee you all the Jews will convert to Christianity. Believe in Jesus. And please do not send me an email saying that I'm not a Christian, I'm Messianic. You're dealing with me now. I don't want to get that. Messianic movement is a sect of the Protestant community, but I don't want to get into that, okay? But I can assure you of this. I encourage any missionary watching this, just take your Christian Bible and just flip it open and just put your finger anywhere. Just pick a verse somewhere, John 14:6. You know, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one can come to the Father but by me. If you can find that in the book of Joshua, if you can find the Nicene Creed somewhere in the book of Exodus, all the Jews are going to believe in Jesus, because that's really all we're interested in, is what the Jewish scripture is saying. And what we're doing is we're encountering everything but scripture from you. We're getting all this white noise rather than a very clear, simple text. I mean, if everything comes down to, if you believe in Jesus, you're saved, and if you don't believe in him, you're going to hell, then that kind of statement, which we would find in the end of the book of Mark, if that statement could be found in Jeremiah, I guarantee you, all the Jews, you're wasting millions of dollars out there with Rabbi Kaduri's letters and making these videos. I'm going to tell you what to do. Just find a text, a clear text, that says, you know, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son so that anyone who believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life, John 3:16. If you can find that in the book of Micah, we'll all accept Jesus as the Messiah. I mean, that's all we're looking for. So, you know, when you go to Las Vegas and you watch a magic show and the magician is doing all this kind of deflecting your attention to produce magic tricks, they're able to do that by just deflecting. We're not interested in that. We're interested in just the Bible. So let me just save you a lot of time. All you need to do is find a passage in the Jewish scriptures that says what you find in the Christian Bible. Okay, that's it. If you do that, if you're successful, like if you ask me why don't Jews eat pork, well, I would point you to Leviticus 11, which says don't eat pork, you know, paraphrasing. Why do we keep Shabbos? It just says keep Shabbos forever. That's why we do it. It says it in the Jewish Bible. If you can't find any passage in the Jewish Bible that clearly says God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, if you can't find the Nicene Creed, the formula of the doctrine of the Trinity that was hammered out in the 4th century under Constantine, if you can't find the Jewish Bible, we want nothing to do with it. It's not that we hate Jesus. It's not that we hate Christianity. We're not crazy about Christianity because they didn't behave well. So it's like Christianity didn't do very well in terms of the way it behaved. But let's set that aside. That's all you need to do. You don't need to do like pulling a bird out of your underwear. You don't need to like do all these little tricks. We're really not looking for this kind of nonsense. We really would like, if you want to make a case, just have a clear text in the Jewish Bible that clearly says that God loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, so that anyone who believed would have everlasting life and not perish. All the Jews will accept Jesus. The reason why we don't accept Jesus, the reason why we don't accept Hare Krishna, the reason why we don't accept the Hindu monkey god called Hanuman, which is very popular in Bali, very popular, is it's not found in It's not found anywhere in the Jewish scriptures. Now, these folks in Bali, sweet people, but they worship idols. Mm-hmm. They're doing miracles in the name of the monkey god, okay? Miracles all over the place, okay? Wow. We don't care. We don't care about the miracles in the name of the monkey god. It's just not relevant to us. They may really be doing those miracles. I haven't seen them, but I heard a lot about it. And it's not relevant to us. I don't care if a Hindu can resurrect the dead. It would not change what I believe, because idolatry, false religions can produce miracles, and the Torah bears testimony to this. And Deuteronomy 13 warns us that false religions can produce supernatural experiences. It doesn't interest us. So I would say this to the leaders of Jews for Jesus. You're spending, I don't know what, $30 million a year, just you alone. Okay, don't bother. Just find a passage from the book of Mark, Matthew, Luke, John. Don't give us Isaiah 53, because we, the Jews who are studying Isaiah, are reading it in context. We're not reading it out of context. And as I said, there's this one guy who gives his whole testimony from it's Chosen People Ministries, I think it is. And he says, you know, if you just read Isaiah 53 and nothing else, you would say it's talking about Jesus. Well, of course, that's exactly what they need to say. They have to say, read Isaiah 53 and nothing else. But as it turns out, Isaiah did intend that you read the chapters that introduce this chapter. And if I take any passage out of context, I can show you that Jesus is the Messiah. For example, I can take Zechariah chapter 13, verse 6. There are missionaries who use this. The passage says you could open up your King James Bible, and it says, in the text says, you know, they will say to him, "What are those wounds between your hands?" It says that. And he will answer, "Those with which I was wounded in the house of my friends." There are missionaries who actually use that to show that the crucifixion was foretold in the book of Zechariah. Well, Zechariah 13, verse 6 does say that. Mohamakus Elo Bene Yudecha, what are these wounds between your hands? It does say that. But the context, Zechariah hoped, and I can speak to Zechariah in this, that you have read Zechariah 13, verse 1 through 5. That you read the verses that introduce it. And therefore, if you read it in context, that's Zechariah 13, verse 6, you will discover that the person who's speaking is a false prophet who will admit his sin, that he had spoken falsely and presumptuously in the name of the Lord, and that he claimed to be a prophet but will really be a false prophet. That's how important a context is. So now let's move on. When missionaries appeal to a supposed letter by Rabbi Kaduri and say, well, this proves that Jesus is the Messiah, what you're advertising, and I'm going to look at this thing in just a moment, but what you're saying is, we don't have anything in the Bible that says that Jesus is the Messiah. That's what you're really doing. The message you're sending out to the Jewish people when you come up with a supposed letter written by one of the greatest rabbis, Kabbalists of the last century. He passed away in the year 2006. I knew him. I was not his disciple, but I studied his teachings. He was a fierce opponent of Christianity. To say that he believed in Jesus, if you make that claim, that's like claiming that Elie Wiesel is a Holocaust denier. If you make the claim that Yasser Arafat was really the chief rabbi of Israel, you're just so outside, you have just become irrelevant. Mm-hmm. So I encourage, because I'm not making this up. The claim of Chosen People Ministries, of Jews for Jesus, of Friends of Israel Gospel Ministries is that you can look at your Bible and it can be demonstrated from the Jewish scriptures that Jesus is the Messiah. And then what happened is we then look at the Jewish Bible and guess what? It isn't there. We don't have anything that resembles what we find in the Gospels. Mm-hmm. It's very, very different. So what you've done is you basically are saying to us, we have given up. We've surrendered. We really don't have a passage in the Jewish Bible. Isaiah 7:14 isn't talking about the Messiah being born to a virgin. So therefore, we have to now make up these letters from a rabbi, even though you claim that you don't follow rabbis, the Messianic movement is very adamant that they don't follow the words of rabbis. They follow the word of God. If you're a Messianic Jew or have ever been in a Messianic congregation, you know I'm telling you the truth. You've heard this over and over again. We are biblical Jews. We're not rabbinic Jews. Well, what do they then do? They turn around and say, we could prove Jesus the Messiah from a letter written by Rabbi Kaduri. Now, I'm just looking here at the letter that you've emailed me here during the show, and I've looked into this letter. I've asked every family member I can get my hands on, is there any letter like this? And no one knows anything about it. None of his disciples, none of the people who are very close, were very close to Rabbi Kaduri, knows anything about it. So this is like out of nowhere this letter exists. The other point I think should be said is that I think that when you watch these videos about Rabbi Kaduri's letter, they make it sound like the letter says that like Jesus is the Messiah. Well, I'm just going to read it here. It's sort of written in a script that's not, scribbled, but it says, Yorim Ho'om V'yochiach Shed Dibru v'tayrosai omdim, which would mean Yorim Om, which means the nation will be raised up, v'yechiach, and it will become known, it will be affirmed, shed dibru v'tayrosai, shed dibru v'tayrosai omdim, that his word and his Torah stands. So there it is. I'm just reading a few. Now, I didn't say anything about Jesus being the Messiah in there. If you did, you're living in an alternative universe.
Is the name Yeshua even in there?
No, so what I'm looking here is that you have the first letter of each, which means the first letter of each word spells Yehoshua, which is would be the name of Moses' disciple. So, by the way, there's an article on our site where I show that the Reverend Yesung Young Moon, his name is all over Isaiah 53. I've got Moon and Hare Krishna all over Zechariah chapter 12. Mm. I mean, I can find you Krishna if you want. If you want Hanuman, I will send you verses all over the Bible. I'm not going to go to some letter written by someone who is in the Obama administration. I could find it in Scripture. Moon is all over the place with acronyms. It's there in nice sequences. I can produce it from today's New York Times if you want it. I mean, you give me today's New York Times, I will find the spaghetti. I will find a flying spaghetti monster for you, okay? I mean, if that's the best you can do. So as it turns out, I just went to a whole range of folks who've been studying under Rabbi Kaduri, and in Rabbi Kaduri, it should be emphasized, lived to somewhere around, it's not exact, he's born in Baghdad, so when he passed away, he could be 106, 110 years old. But that means what is very important, that he lived so long, is that people have been around him for a century. People have been around him forever. So therefore, it's not like he passed away when he was very young, like Ramosha Chaim Litzata, who passed away in his 30s. This is a man who's, you know, had a huge following. He was perhaps the greatest Kabbalist in the land of Israel. So this would be all over the place. As it turns out, this is a forgery. By every account. Go ahead.
What does that first line read at the very top? Are you looking at the one with the red dots on it, or the red highlights on the letters? Is that the one you have?
Yeah, that's
okay. What I'm looking at. What is that very top line that says Moshiach? Looks like an upside down ion at the top.
No, it's scribbled. So Be'inyan Hadas. Or it could be, I see two dots on top. I don't know if that would be an acronym or not. And then Shal Mashiach, which means of the Messiah. So that's what it says there.
Interesting. So this, does it, actually, so basically this, they're saying, or he supposedly wrote all of this. That's interesting.
All right. Yeah. So This is dated in Tufshin Mem Hei, which would correspond to 2005. And then the letter ends like that is very legible, Yitzhak Kaduri. It could be the quality of the image you're sending me isn't great, but that's very clear.
Okay.
So what I think would be very valuable is to find a passage in the Jewish scriptures. That's what I think would be very compelling. And if all you can do is come up with a letter that no one ever saw, no one ever heard about, and say, well, if you go to the first letter of each word, and that spells Yehoshua, which is the name of Joshua, which also means, it should be said, that the name Yehoshua also means salvation. That's mm-hmm. what the name means. So, I mean, if this is, again, not the case, but I could just say he's writing salvation. The name Yehoshua would mean salvation or salvation of God. Mm-hmm. It doesn't, right? Okay, so, to me, as a Jew, I'm looking at this, and this is very telling, because what you're saying, when missionaries are offering a letter by Rabbi Yitzhak Kaduri, that, and I'm not going to get into the point that no one knows where this letter came from. By every account of people who would know, this is a forgery. No one ever heard about such a letter that no one was supposed to open until a year after he passed away. No one's aware of this. Mm-hmm. But if this is what missionaries have to do, what I think is very important is they're advertising that we don't have anything in the Bible. Mm-hmm. We need to use these kinds of letters to convince you that Jesus is the Messiah. And let me just pose it this way. If it's said in the book of Amos, if it's said in the book of Leviticus, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that anyone who would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Let's say it's said that in Leviticus chapter 70. There is no chapter 70, so let's just say it's said that, okay? Sure. I want you to walk through this with me. Would they be pointing to Rabbi Kaduri's letter? Hmm. Think about that. William, I want to ask you this question. You have probably lost friends because you've embraced the Jewish faith and left Christianity,
absolutely,
right?
Yes.
You've paid a price for that, right?
Totally.
That was not free. It would have been a lot more convenient for you, William, if you had just stayed in the church or stayed in the Messianic movement, your relationship with many friends, perhaps fail, I don't know this, would have not been injured, and you paid a very heavy price for doing what you knew to be right. Mm-hmm. Right? Now I know you did this. You paid that enormous social cost because you had to follow the truth. Mm-hmm. If there was a verse in the book of Numbers that said, if you believe in Jesus, you'll be saved, and if you don't believe in him, you'll be damned, Mark chapter 16, verse 20, you would have never left the church. You would have stayed a Christian. Am mm-hmm. I right or
That's
wrong?
That's correct. That's correct.
Of course you would have. If we would find the Carmen Christi of Philippians 2, if you can find that in the book of Judges, the hundreds and hundreds of thousands of Messianics and Christians who are leaving in droves from the church, they wouldn't be leaving. They'd be staying, and I'd be a Christian. If you had the doctrine of the Trinity, the Nicene Creed, in the Torah, we'd all believe in Jesus. We just want to see it in the Bible. So the Kaduri letter, the fact that the missionaries need to appeal to this letter, I want to set aside that the letter doesn't say Jesus is the Messiah, doesn't say anything. You do the acronym, and I will find you moon in Isaiah 53. But setting that aside, the reason they have to go to do these things, they got to do these magic tricks and pull like little foam balls out of people's ears, is because they don't have a text. If there was a text, they wouldn't need Rabbi Kaduri's letter. It would be unnecessary. The reason they need to find the letter that's supposedly Rabbi Kaduri, and then, you know, when you watch these videos, it says, and the letter proclaimed that Jesus is the Messiah. Well, even if I were to say that this letter is authentic, there's nothing that says that Jesus is the Messiah. It doesn't say that here, so that's nonsense as well. But again, Chosen People Ministries, all you need to do is find a passage. So that means This is all you do. Open your book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, anything you want. Pick any verse, blind, and you find that verse in the book of Joshua that's about Jesus. We'll go with it. If you find a text that has been plagiarized from the Jewish scriptures, like from the book of Mark, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and might. Well, they just took that from our Bible, and mm-hmm. so did the Islam took stuff, but there's nothing there about Jesus. Find something about Jesus, and you've got thousands of Jews who are going to accept it. But we only use the Bible. We don't do this. I'm going to make this last point. This practice of forgery in order to get people to believe in Jesus or to advance a Christian doctrine is as old as the church itself. There are books like the Epistle of Barnabas. You have the Gospel of Peter, Gospel of Thomas. These are all forgeries. These are all done by Christians who knew they were lying. They knew that Paul didn't write the gospel. Well, they knew it. They wrote it anyway because the ends justify the means. And this is a practice the church has been engaged in for 2,000 years. And they do it to their own Bible. They insert the doctrine of the Trinity into the first epistle of John, an anonymous doctrine. Mm. But they put it in there. They admit they put it in there. The whole story of the adulterous woman in John 7 and 8. That's a later interpolation. They know it is. It's in your Christian commentary. So if Christian scribes were perfectly willing and able to manipulate their own Bible and the Jewish Bible, which they considered sacred, what do you think they'll do to Rabbi Kaduri? I mean, they'll dance on his grave. What mm-hmm. do you think they would do to, of course they'll do this kind of stuff. This is an ancient practice of the church.
So are you telling me that even if, I know this sounds kind of crazy, even if they dug up the burial place of Rashi and they found in his coat pocket a letter that said, I had a vision that Jesus was the Messiah or Yeshua was the Messiah, you would still not be allowed to believe it because the Torah says otherwise. No matter who wrote the letter.
Of course. If, for example, any rabbi said that Hare Krishna is God, is a deity, would I become a Hindu? Would you? I mean, no. And by the way, I can march out, and William, you know this, mm-hmm. I couldn't even count the number of Christian pastors, Messianic leaders, Christian scholars who have converted to Judaism. Mm-hmm. And that's on YouTube. I don't have some weird letter no one heard about.
Right.
There are thousands of Christian leaders who have converted to Judaism or have become B'nai Noach, and we all know that. Mm-hmm. And I don't march them out. You know, I don't go, this is why you shouldn't believe in Jesus, because the head of Jews for Jesus or the head of Chosen People Ministries or the head of a Messianic congregation doesn't believe in Jesus anymore mm-hmm. and has embraced Torah Judaism. Mm-hmm. But in truth, if we look at our Bible, what is our Bible filled with? Tanakh. Mm-hmm. In fact, I would submit that the Jewish scriptures contains an enormous record of Jews who did exactly that, of Jews like Menashe, who grew up in a Orthodox Jewish home. His father was Hezekiah, a man of God. And guess what? He worshiped Baal. So maybe I should worship Baal too, because Menashe, an Orthodox Jew, worshiped Baal. Maybe I should do that. Maybe I should, I mean, who were all these Jews that worship idols in the Bible? They did it. Mm-hmm. These were Orthodox, there was no reform or conservative movement then. So the Jewish scriptures is filled with anecdotal information, with testimonies and records of Jews who in fact worshiped other gods. It's not hidden. The grandson of Moses worshiped idols and set up idols. It's in the Bible. He mm-hmm. did it. So right. Should I do that too? So of course not. That's obscene. There were Jews who left Egypt and worshiped the golden calf. So I should worship the golden calf too? So of course that's preposterous. I don't have any message like that. What the Torah does say in Deuteronomy is do not, 4 verse 2, don't err to the word nor take away from it. So I would expect, anticipate to encounter Jews who grew up in a traditional home to worship idolatry, because Tanakh, the Hebrew Bible, is filled with mm-hmm. people, characters like this. And the Torah's message is, don't follow them. Don't go after these people. They're speaking presumptuously in my name. I'm So therefore, I expect to find Jews who grew up in a traditional home to worship idolatry. Now, as it turns out, the Jews who joined Jews for Jesus are almost all Jews who grew up in a non-observant home. Virtually all of them have. But the Jewish scripture is all about Jews who grew up in an Orthodox home who eventually worship Baal. So should I worship Baal too? Like, what is
sure.
it? Would you do that?
Not at all.
All right. So that's silly.
Okay. This other guy that was in the picture you saw, something, what was his name? I've got him pulled up here. There's, when I listen to this video, just for grins as I'm talking, I'm just going to play this down low for a minute.
You've got to first shave your head. You dress all in black. You've got to wear.
You remember this, Rabbi?
Eat only kosher foods. You've got to become a vegetarian. You face Jerusalem. You've got to face India when you pray. You pray only in Hebrew, and you grow a nice big beard. And if you do all of those outward cultural things, you'll discover the God of the universe.
Okay, now I could only listen to about a minute and a half or 2 minutes of this, and the very first thing when he did, when he mentioned the whole idea of Isaiah 53, I immediately just like. This is nonsense, you know. And you know what it reminded me, Rabbi? It reminded me of remember when you were when Sid Roth. It wasn't during the debate that he was hosting with you and Michael Brown that he edited out and chopped up, but it was in one of his little CDs or DVDs that you said he gets to missionize Jews, and he talks about Zechariah 13.
Whenever, sex is in there, yeah.
And the fact that Sid Roth would use such a thing that clearly the context states is talking about a false prophet, not a good prophet. That's the first gut feeling that I got as I was watching this. Now I'm not that overly educated like the rabbis, like you are, Rabbi Singer, but there's just red flags all over it altogether. Now, did you watch this video? I think you said you might've seen it.
If we're talking about the same guy, I did. I mean, what was
Bala? What's his name? Ballaston, Mordecai Ballaston.
It did not having grown up in the most traditional Orthodox Jewish home, it didn't strike me as very credible. Maybe the stories, the anecdotes are there true. The key point that I found very striking was that he said, and Sid Roth has done this as well in many missions. If you read Isaiah 53 just alone, you know, you'll believe it's talking about Jesus. Well, if you read, so it is important. I want to make this point very clear. Isaiah never intended that the 53rd chapter should be ambiguous, should be puzzling. He never imagined that.
Or isolated.
He presupposed, however, that if you're reading Isaiah 53, you have read the chapters that introduce it. Mm-hmm. Therefore, if you're reading Isaiah, presuppose, I can assure you this, that if you're reading his 53rd chapter, you've read the 41st chapter, verse 8 and 9, which explicitly says that Israel is my servant. You have read the 42nd chapter at the end where it says my servant is blind. You read the 43rd chapter, which says that you are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen. You read 44 verse 1, which says Israel and Jacob is my servant. 44 verse 21. You read 45 verse 4. You read 48 verse 21. You read 49 verse 3. I'm just giving you a hint. Mm-hmm. If you read all that, well, you'll know immediately who Isaiah 53 is speaking about the nation of Israel in the singular. It's all he's been doing leading up to it. But yes, if I strip the text out of context, it's going to be puzzling. And this is what happens to Christians. And that's why I say these Christians, I'm not talking about the leaders for a moment. They're really good people who are, they know Isaiah 53 by heart. They know those 15 verses like right off the bat. But if you ask them, like, what does it say in Isaiah 49? They have no clue. Mm-hmm. Or they say, I've got to look it up. Or you try it out. Say, when you meet a Jews for Jesus missionary on the street, they quote Isaiah 3, just say, what does it say in Isaiah 49? Like, pick any verse in Isaiah 40. Mm-hmm. They'll say, I've got to get my Bible, and ask them, well, why did you have to get your Bible? You knew 53 by heart. Why? Well, there's a price you're going to pay for that asymmetrical knowledge. Mm-hmm. You have one chapter. Look, we'll even ignore, setting aside there are deliberate mistranslations of the 53rd chapter. They don't know who's speaking. They don't know who it's speaking about. They have no idea why. They're reading it in a context. This is why Christians will run from Christianity the moment they study. The reason Christians will leave the church and embrace the God of Israel and come to the Jewish faith like that. The reason they leave so quickly is when they discover this, when they're confronted with the text right in front of them, when they see what Hebrews chapter 8 did with Jeremiah 31, changed the word of God, they leave skid marks. They mm-hmm. they want nothing to do with this, and rightfully so. You know, but that's why Christians leave the church so easily. It's because they've been set up to believe, they've been taught to believe that if you look at the Jewish Bible, it's all about Jesus. When they see that their Bible has been altered, that they've been taught passages out of context, that Matthew misappropriated prophecies, that verses in the book of Psalm chapter 22, where in a Christian Bible it says, they pierced my hands and my feet, and that's not in the Hebrew text. It's in the Hebrew text, like a lion there in my hands and my feet. It's been changed, been altered. It isn't even quoted in the Christian Bible, because in the first century, no one had such a reading. Mm-hmm. When they find, these are good people in churches like the Assemblies of God and Southern Baptist churches. When they discover that this is what's been done to them, they leave, and they're angry. I'm not really angry. I've never been a Christian, so I don't feel that anger, but in truth, the former Christians, they're really angry at the church because they've wasted 25 years of their lives in idolatry, and it hurts them. They're very resentful about this.
Wow. You know what? This guy that played the little audio clip from, my initial feeling is him. I'm wondering if he even knows Hebrew. I wonder if he was raised in a religious household, or was it a secular household? You know, he kind of wondered these things.
It's true. It's commonplace, as I've mentioned, for missionaries to exaggerate their religious affiliation and to say they were Jewish when they weren't Jewish, or say they went to an Orthodox yeshiva, their ordination, they're fluent, you know, all these kinds mm-hmm. of claims when in fact none of it's true. The Bible tells, in Tanakh, we see Orthodox Jews, and that's not a term that was used, that's a modern term, but Jews coming from a traditional home, we find in Tanakh, worshipped idols. It's all over the Jewish scriptures, and they were admonished for that. So, in fact, I know why Christianity wasn't able to replicate that. Baal was very successful at that. Christianity was has been very unsuccessful at converting Orthodox Jews to Christianity. The reason why Baal was very successful, and I'm just taking a biblical idol, and Jews for Jesus failed at converting Jews who have my background, is very simple. And that is that Baal, the religion of Baal, never made the claim that I can prove that Baal is God, because it's prophesied in the book of Hosea. You see? So because they made that claim, so you either believe it or you don't believe it. The reason why religious Jews, you know, just don't convert to Christianity, was very unusual to happen. It has happened, but it's very, very unusual, is because of the book of Matthew, because of these supposed fulfillment citations. It's very, very hard to believe in a lie. That's sure. the reason.
Sure.
Okay.
Okay, Rebbe, we've got a caller calling in. Hello, welcome to Tanakh Talk. Who do we have on the phone today? Hello, can you hear us? I hear some a TV or something playing in the background mildly. Okay, we'll go on to the next question. Okay, Rabbi, a different kind of, well, actually a big change of topic. This is a question my son came up with last night as we were talking about things. And he said, you know, it shows that there are seven heavens. What are they, or what are they for? And are they different levels? Are they four different levels of righteousness? Like whenever, you know, he said, well, like when we die, you know, you've got all these different people. Some of them were rabbis. Some of them were, you know, not even Noahides. I mean, how does all that work? Is that even the concept? And, you know, whenever he asked the question, I was like, wow, I never even pondered that idea myself. I mean, what's the idea with seven heavens?
Yeah, so there is... The idea of seven heavens could be found in Islam. It's very prominent. In Judaism, it is not as prominent. There is a discussion of it in the Talmud. There is a discussion of it where there are different... this is not heaven, like when you look at the sky, you see clouds. But there are levels of heights of an encounter with God, and I cannot explain it. It is discussed in there is an allusion to it in Psalm 68. There is some Talmudic description of it, but there's just very little information on it. And therefore, I couldn't describe it to you because this is an area that our ears, our eyes, our natural senses are not keyed for, are not wired for. So I couldn't explain that to you.
Okay. And I know, like you had mentioned many times before in Judaism, it's about here and now more than it is about what's going to happen later.
It's a little different than that. Let me explain.
Could you explain? Yeah,
that'd be
great.
It's like trying to teach Mozart to a fetus. It just, the apparatus is not there. The Bible does not engage in seeking to explain something that we cannot apprehend. So we have more detailed information about the things that we can completely understand, that a person's grave is a temporary dwelling place, and that there is a resurrection of the dead. So we have very graphic texts that explain that describe that, because that's something that we can wrap our brain around, because here is the souls of those who have passed away returning back to their bodies, their bones resurrecting from their graves. And that's a promise of TESHUVAH. It's a fundamental tenet of the Jewish faith, but it's easy to understand. But everything that we process is through our eyes, our ears, our tastes, our senses, and none of those senses work. None of them function in this completely spiritual world where there is nothing physical. So I can tell you now a description of what heaven is like, but it won't be meaningful. I could tell you that there are righteous people who are in these places of heaven, and they're sitting. It doesn't mean that they actually have a pelvis that they can sit. But they're sitting, and they have crowns on their head, and they enjoy the intense splendor of God's light and presence. That's it. That's our soul that's experiencing that, but there's nothing physical about that. And then those souls are restored back for the resurrection. The Torah does not engage in explaining something that we cannot apprehend. The Torah is simply saying that the soul is immortal, can't be destroyed. It leaves the body when a person dies, Ecclesiastes 12:7, but it does not describe what we cannot apprehend. And if Tanakh if there was a way of conveying this, if the Tanakh did use more voluptuous words, it actually would be problematic, because we would take it, no doubt, in a hyper-literal way and misunderstand the message. Mm. And that's why there's no point in engaging in describing something that we cannot understand. But we do trust that God keeps his promise, not on a blind faith, but because we know that God has kept every other promise that he has made.
Sure.
That's what Torah is always saying. I've kept my promise and I will. So therefore, the things that we can understand, and the Bible tells us this, the secret things belong to the Lord, but that which has been revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may keep all the words of this Torah. So I want to make this point. Are there mysteries in Judaism? The answer is, of course there are. Are there things in the Jewish faith that we cannot understand? The answer is yes. What there is not in Judaism is contradiction. There's no contradiction. The doctrine of Trinity contradicts and is an enemy, is opposed by the Jewish scriptures. So there is mystery. And in fact, if I can completely apprehend the infinite, then it wouldn't be infinite because I'm finite. I have finite tools. So I could engage in explanations, the Talmud, but they wouldn't make sense. And I have learned in the past that when engaging in that type of, you're quoting these things that are not to be meant to be taken in a hyper-literal sense, people misapply it, misappropriate it, misunderstand it. It doesn't edify God. It's just that we, because it's not a blind faith, you know, just like when you go to your mom's house and she serves you dinner, you don't have to take out a kit that can test the presence of cyanide to see if she hasn't poisoned your food.
Sure.
You know, when you go through TSA flying, they swipe your stuff down that to make sure there's no bomb material. Well, when you go to your mom's house, you don't have to swipe your chair down to make sure that your mom hasn't put explosives on your chair. Mm-hmm. Does that mean that you have blind faith that your mother's not trying to kill you? No, it's not blind faith. It's just your mom has done everything possible to keep you alive, sustain you. So you can be sure based on her behavior that she's done everything to protect you and love you, that she's not going to try to poison you. God has kept every promise, and it is on that basis that we can then trust that God will come through for us in the future. It's not a blind faith, but I will say this. One of the things I discovered is that when growing up in a traditional home, going to yeshiva, going to rabbinical school and so on, we didn't get into these things. We didn't get into demons, and we didn't get into what are these seven heavens. We just didn't, because Tanakh is not oriented that way, and Jewish literature is not oriented that way. We got into what does God want from us, because that's what Tanakh is how to behave in this world, knowing that there's a world to come, and then that's in God's hands, that's not in our hands. We know there's reward and punishment, without which there would be, there will be no justice in the world. If Anne Frank and Adolf Hitler both died really in close proximity to each other, and both of them had the same end, that means the lights went out, there's no afterlife, then there's no justice in the world. It couldn't be. That couldn't be the case. But Tanakh is not going to play games with us and tell us about gnashing teeth, like there are teeth gnashing in hell, as described in the Christian Bible. That's nonsense. But sure. That's Dante's hell. You know, the Gospel of Peter does this, incidentally. The Gospel of Peter actually, which it almost made into the New Testament, describes hell very vividly of what hell looks like. Of people being held by fire by what part of their body committed sins. We have that in Christian literature that never made it into the Christian Bible. But there are, it gets more, you know, the Christian literature improves. I'm using the word in italics, but it gets more elaborate as time goes on.
Sure. Okay.
All right, let's move on.
Okay, very good. Hello, welcome to Tanakh Talk. This is William. Who do we have on the phone?
Hello.
Yes, hello. How are you?
Shalom.
Shalom, shalom. Welcome to Tanakh Talk.
Yeah, shalom. I have a question for the rabbi. And thank you very much for the program. And there's a messianic, whatever they want to call them, like rabbis, whatever, that he claimed that that without shedding of blood, you know, the same story, mm-hmm. that without shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sin. And he claimed that when Daniel was praying, you know, three times, facing towards the temple, that there were still going sacrifices going on over there in the temple, and also there's that's the reason that today the Orthodox community still do kaparot with the rooster or whatever. They still do Shehita in Yom Kippur. I'm going to listen to the answer of the rabbi, please.
Okay, Rabbi, did you gather all of his questions?
Yeah, I sure did.
Okay.
I'm really glad he asked that question.
Okay, what is your name?
Thank you very much.
What is your name?
Joseph.
Joseph, where are you calling from?
Florida.
Okay, Joseph from Florida. Thank you so much for calling. And Rabbi, we'll get right on your answer.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
All right. Let's just take that one part at a time. Daniel praying three times a day, and it is in the Bible. He prayed. It's an amazing thing that happened. The temple was not standing. If someone said that the temple was standing when Daniel did this, they're either incredibly ignorant,
right?
And they're also then obviously if they're the leaders, then imagine how ignorant the followers are, or they're being dishonest. This occurs in Daniel chapter 6. In chapter 6, we know exactly when Daniel did this, because this took place precisely 50 years after the destruction of the first temple, immediately after the fall of the Babylonian Empire. When the Babylonian Empire collapsed, the Persian Empire emerged. There was an interim period of a very short time where there was a king. His name was Darius, but he's not the Persian Darius later, but he's Darius the Mede. According to a consensus opinion, he was almost certainly Cyrus's father-in-law. But whatever it is, it was in the family. So we have a brief period where, just to give the background, Daniel was like, let's just say, the vice president of Babylon. It's not exactly correct, but he was in the Secretary of State of Babylon. He ran the show for Nebuchadnezzar and those who would follow him. And he was a genius. He was everything. He was brilliant, and he taught them, the people, about time and all the great wisdom he taught them. Now, what happens is a new empire rises up, and this is the Persian Empire. We know this. It's right. Just read it for yourself. This happens in the time of Darius the Mede, who was really a great guy. It's one of those individuals, Darius the Mede, who's underplayed, and I don't know why that is. There should be a lot more literature about how fabulous this individual was. Please read it for yourself. Now, what happens is now let's talk about the temple. The Babylonian exile, or the period between the first and second temple, was 70 years. Everybody knows that. Well, if this is happening after the fall of the Babylonian Empire, but at the time of the emergence of the Persian Empire, that means this occurred 20 years before the second temple was built. 20 years. There was no temple. This is just object nonsense. It does not, if you read the passage for yourself, there's nothing it says he, well, now what happened was, let me just, this is an amazing event. There were people who were also, let's say Daniel was, we'll call him Secretary of State. Well, there were other members of the cabinet, satraps. These were people who were very powerful, and they were very jealous of Daniel, and they set him up. And they basically passed a law that every person in the empire has to pray to Darius, the king. He has to pray to the king. We'll just call him the Persian king. Now, this was a setup because they knew that Daniel was faithful to the God of Israel. They knew that he would not betray the true God of Israel. He was already thrown into a fire. They knew he would defy this. So there's this prayer that there is this new law that is passed that if you don't pray to the king of Persia, then you're going to be killed. Now, Daniel had an opportunity here. If you pray to anybody else, you'll also be put to death for that. That was a setup to get rid of Daniel because they were really jealous of him. Now, Daniel could have gotten away with it by making life really easy. He could have gone into the basement. He could have gone to some subterranean room and could have prayed to the God of Israel. And he could have done that privately had possibly gotten away with it. But he didn't do that. What he did instead was, if you read the passage, as soon as this document was signed, he did the worst thing you can do, unless you wanted to get yourself killed. That is, he went up into the tower. Well, go to the closet, Daniel. Everyone's going to see you. No, he didn't do that. He stood literally at the window. That means everyone could see it. And he prayed three times a day facing Jerusalem. There's nothing in there that there were sacrifices going on in Jerusalem. So he publicly displayed his devotion to the God of Israel and his defiance of this law. Now, as it turned out, Darius the Mede was a little weak, and he really was unhappy with the situation, but sort of he felt he couldn't fight it. But he was rooting for Daniel. Daniel eventually was thrown into a den of lions because this was the punishment, and Darius the Mede was really hoping that Daniel would survive and God would do something miraculous for him. It's really a very moving chapter where Daniel is thrown into a den of ravenous, hungry lions that would have torn him to pieces, but they didn't do that. And in fact, when the morning came, Darius the Mede came to see and hoping that Daniel survived and God would do a miracle for him. And in fact, that's what happened. And he's one of these Gentiles in the Bible who really is very, very unique, very special to have done that. He was really rooting for Daniel, and just read it there for yourself. So let's talk about that. So that's very simple. There's no sacrifices going on. We are told in the Bible, in 1 Kings chapter 8, King Solomon, when he inaugurated the first temple, he said that one day you're going to be thrown out of the land and you're not going to have a temple. You're not going to have this place. You're not going to have what you do in exile in the land of your enemies, be it far, be it near. Please read it for yourself. It's in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 46 to 50, but read it in context. You know that I'm not taking it out of context. It's the inauguration of the first temple. King Solomon says that when you're in exile and you don't have the temple, you face Jerusalem, this place, and God will and repent for your sins, and God will hear your prayers in heaven and forgive you for your transgressions. By the way, that would have been a really great place for God so loved the world. If God had a plan that remotely resembled the teachings of the church, King Solomon would have said, don't worry, when you're not in the temple, you're going to have my son who's going to die for your sins. It's not there. What it does say there is exactly how religious Jews live, and that is when we pray, we face Jerusalem based on these passages. And what we do when we are moved to repent, we confess our sins and turn away from those sins because we have a promise that God will hear your prayers in heaven and he will forgive you for all your transgressions. Please, again, look it up for yourself. It doesn't say that anyone has to die. It doesn't say that you need a blood sacrifice. None of that. Now, the other part of the question I heard was that the person who called in said that his messianic leader says that it says in the Torah that without the shedding of blood, there's no atonement. That is also completely untrue. That quote is a text found in the Christian Bible. That's found in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22. In Hebrews 9:22, it says, without the shedding of blood, there's no atonement. That doesn't say that anywhere in the Jewish scriptures. Now, if you had a Christian study Bible, which means one that had annotation, or at least had footnotes and cross-referencing, it would tell you in Hebrews 9:22 that you can define this passage in Leviticus 17:11. Okay, but if you then turn to the Torah, to Leviticus 17:11, it doesn't say that. Leviticus 17:11 is taken out of context. Leviticus 17, what we encounter is the prohibition of eating blood. One, it is forbidden, the Torah says, to eat blood. We're not allowed to drink blood. When I was in rabbinical school, the way students made a few dollars on the side is we worked in a slaughterhouse. Blood, when the blood came out of the animal, we covered it over with dirt, and that goes on to this day, rendering it unusable. That the blood, because the blood is set aside, the Torah says, for one purpose, and that is to make an atonement. That's it. And we know what kind of atonement that is, because again, we've already read Leviticus 4, where it's a sin sacrifice, a sin that's committed unintentionally, or an asham sacrifice, Leviticus 5, where the sin may or may not have been intentional, but in that case, the person confesses the sin. There is no sacrifice for intentional sins. It might be for sins against the sanctuary, where a person deliberately or unintentionally brought a sacrifice in the temple or defiled the temple in a state of impurity. It might be that. So Leviticus 17:11 begins with, this is because, so it's explaining Leviticus 10. So the Leviticus, there is no verse anywhere in the Jewish Bible that says that without the shedding of blood, there is no atonement. That is found in the book of Hebrews. Now, what Hebrews is seeking to do is to explain, why do you need Jesus' death for sin? Why is this necessary? So Hebrews sets this up in multiple layers. So what is Hebrews, when we get to Hebrews 9, Hebrews already makes the claim that Jesus was the high priest, which would have been impossible if he was from the house of David. You couldn't be the high priest. Then what he's going to say is that you absolutely need blood for an atonement. So that's the next layer. That's also not true. We can look at King David, who repented through by confessing his sin. The people of Nineveh can give you just endless examples of people who repented and followed the instructions of King Solomon, who followed the instructions in Hosea 6:6, Micah 6:6. Look it up for yourself, please. And then what it goes to, the next question is, Hebrews is addressing a conundrum. If the sacrificial system atoned for all sins, which it says earlier on, then why do you need Jesus? Why not just have the animal sacrifices continually? So the point that Hebrews is the case, the claim that the author of Hebrews, who we don't know who wrote it, is that the sacrificial system was always temporal. That means animal sacrifices, and they're all really foreshadowing and pointing to Jesus. And that's what Jesus is. Jesus is the fulfillment of the sacrificial system. And Hebrews will make that case in the following chapter, in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 5 and 6, where it misquotes Psalm 40, verse 6 and 7. I know I'm moving quickly through the text because time is limited for the show, but in Hebrews it says, sacrifices and offerings thou hast not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. The point of it that Hebrews is making is that God didn't want sacrifice, animal sacrifice, but he wanted the body of Jesus. Now, in order for the author of Hebrews to advance that, it changed Psalm 40, verse 6 and 7. King David says, if you go to the original passage, and you can do this in your King James Bible, if you go to the King James in Psalm 40, verse 6 and 7, it says there, sacrifices and offerings you do not desire, aznayim karisali, my ears you have opened. So Hebrews took the words, my ears you have opened, deleted them, inserted a body you prepared. Like, where did you get that from? How did you change the word? This is why Jews don't believe in Jesus. There are no scales over our eyes. We don't hate Jesus or anything. It just, when you engage in this kind of chicanery, whoever wrote Hebrews, whoever did this, I doubt it was Paul, but certainly someone in that Pauline thinking, we're gone. We're out of there. You know, it's just like, when it's three cod monte, we're not interested. So that's what Hebrews 10 is making that case. So there is no verse like this. Hebrews 9:22 is a misquote of Leviticus 17:11. Hebrews 10 verse 5 and 6, a misquote of Psalm 40 verse 6 and 7. And then Hebrews finally says that there'll never be a sacrifice for sin in verse 18 because Jesus was the final sacrifice. I want to get to the last point ask the question about, and that is, there's a tradition on the eve of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, that religious Jews, many of them, take a chicken and hold it over their head, and they do that to bring about an atonement for their sins. Okay, they wave it over, that animal is latest slaughtered, killed, and given to the poor. So the the claim is advanced by missionaries that, oh, you see, the Jews are still engaging in a sacrificial system because they use a chicken on the eve of Yom Kippur to take on their sins. See, the Jews know you need an animal to take on your sins. Okay, so, I mean, I for all the religious Jews who are listening or watching the show, I'm really sorry because I know that really hurt to hear that, but that's in fact what's being said. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's talk about this for a moment. Why is a chicken used? Why do they use a chicken? That was the whole reason why a chicken is used. The chicken is used specifically because chicken is a kosher animal, it's a clean animal, but it's never used for a sacrifice. A chicken is never, there's no sacrifice that would accommodate a chicken. Okay, so very deliberately, but the Bible does tell us in Proverbs, all over scriptures, Daniel says in chapter 4, verse 27, that if you give charity, your sins will be forgiven. We're told this all over the Bible, that giving charity atones for sins. Okay, so therefore, what religious Jews do is we follow scripture. We say, well, I want to give charity. Now, there's a number of ways to feed a hungry person. You can give money, but that means he has to go to the store and buy a chicken, you know, and then go slaughter the chicken and go. Or what we can do is we can actually give a person a chicken, not just money, but give them the chicken. And that's what that is. The religious Jews hold the chicken over their head because this is going to be donated to the poor. This tradition was very, very specific in selecting this bird, because this bird is never used as part of a sacrifice. There's no sacrifice that includes a chicken, okay? So they chose it just so no one should ever say that this is a sacrificial system. They specifically use a chicken. And the chicken, after its wave, saying, I'm giving, this is going to be my atonement. That means this is going to the poor to feed the poor. The chicken is then given to a shochet, who slaughters it, and then it is given to a home where people are hungry, have nothing to eat, and therefore they have fed the poor. So the act of waving a chicken over their head, specifically saying, I am giving this charity so that God will forgive my sins. Therefore, my friends, there are many people who are uncomfortable about holding a chicken. There are people who are concerned they may not hold this bird because they're alive when they do this. There are people who are afraid that they may cause the chicken discomfort in holding, because I grew up in New York. We didn't have chickens all over the place. You know, chickens came in styrofoam. So there's a great concern of causing pain or discomfort to an animal. So therefore, there is, the custom is very clear that if you don't have a chicken or you don't want to use a chicken, you put money in a handkerchief. And you can open up any Jewish prayer book and it'll tell you this custom. And then you take the money and hold the money over your head and then give that money to the poor. So the act of kaparis, which means atonement, on Yom Kippur, of holding a chicken over your head, is an act of charity. And the Bible says that giving charity atones for sin. And that's why the chicken is chosen. So this is charity. This is following scripture. It is not a sacrificial system. And that's why the whole reason why chickens were chosen. Why don't they hold a turtle dove over their head? Why not a turtle dove? That would be, you can't do that for this custom. Why? Because then people might think, well, turtle doves are used for sacrifices. So we don't do that. We only use a chicken. The chicken's never used for a sacrifice, but it's a kosher animal.
That's really cool. I never knew that before. I never really looked into it. I just knew it was part of the culture and part of the way they do things. I just had no idea. But that makes perfect sense. They're not killing this chicken to atone for their sins. They're slaughtering the chicken so that this chicken, you know, can be used as food for a poor family, which is
exactly what happens.
That's perfect.
This is part of my, you know, when I was a child growing up, I mean, there's something I saw that this food was given out to poor families because Proverbs chapter 10, verse 2 specifically says that the treasures of wickedness will help no one, but charity will save you from death. Open up your Bible, read Proverbs 11, verse 4. It's right in there. Read Proverbs 16, verse 6. It's right there. Read Hosea 6, 6. Please. I mean, just open your Bible now, and not because Tovia said so, or maybe I'm really persuasive. I didn't sneak into your house and put that in your Bible. The Bible says, I desire loving kindness and not sacrifice. The knowledge of God more than burnt offering. It's with loving kindness, that's what will iniquity will be expiated. It's through giving, and in fact, read Daniel 4, verse 24. In a Christian Bible, just so you know, we don't count the verses the same. So it's Daniel 4, 24 in a Jewish Bible, but in a Christian Bible, it would be found in 4, verse 27. Hmm. Just read it for yourself. That's all. Nice. How do you redeem your error? By giving charity. This is the advice Daniel gives. Bingo. Mm-hmm. That's why a chicken is used. Because, this is only recent that people didn't handle chickens. In Europe, before, people lived in Anatevka, and everyone had chickens. People knew how to handle chickens. And the thing you did was you took a chicken, which was now going to be given to a hungry family that didn't have food to put on the table, that children were crying because they haven't eaten protein in days. Mm-hmm. And they say, I'm giving this to the poor to fulfill what the Bible says, that is, giving charity atones for sin, lest this be misconstrued to think that this is a sacrificial system. We are going to select a chicken mm-hmm. rather than a turtle dove, rather than another creature that is used for sacrifice. So no one could ever construe this to be a part of a sacrificial system. Well, leave it to Jesus for mm-hmm. Jesus to do exactly that.
Well, I'll tell you, we have chickens at our house, and I can tell you firsthand, chickens, they can tolerate a lot of different movement. My daughter, I wished I had the picture to put up for you. She has one particular chicken of ours that's her favorite, and she treats it like it's a stuffed animal. She she picks it up, she runs through the house with it, she takes it and sets it inside a little baby stroller, and it just sits there. Like, let me know when you're done so I can go back outside. So, and they really are highly tolerant of things unless you're just being cruel to them. So with all that said, yeah, I don't see how that could be construed as wrong with this information.
Do you have a Bible in front of you? I mean, could you read for everyone Daniel 4, verse 24?
I can literally pull it up in just moments.
Or 4:27, depending which Bible you have, but just
okay.
Do it.
Okay, I mean, very good.
So I want you to be sure. I'm not doing any Isaiah 53 on you. I mean,
sure.
It's there, graphic. Just read that so everyone okay. can hear it.
All right. So it's pulling up right now. Okay, that was Daniel 4:24.
If it's a Jewish, if it's a Christian Bible, it's verse 27. If it's a Jewish Bible, it's 24.
Okay, Daniel, why did it go to one? Hang on, I got to retype it. It didn't take my number. Daniel... Chapter that was saying, four. That was oh, that's why my numbers lock is on 4:27. Yeah. All right, very good. Okay, wherefore, O King, let my counsel be acceptable unto thee, and break off thy sins by righteousness, and
thine by charity,
and yeah. thine iniquities by showing mercy to the poor, charity.
Oh,
and if that's true, whoa. I never noticed it. Oh,
I didn't put it there. Did I like sneak into your computer? So. I mean, that's what they're doing. Yeah, we're following the Bible. Welcome to Judaism. Mm-hmm. Okay, all the folks out there who don't, this is Judaism. But you can see, my brothers and sisters, that ignorance is so dangerous to a relationship with God. I mean, just ask, and ask someone who would know. And if you're getting stupid answers or doesn't make, if the answer doesn't resonate, go to a rabbi who really is a scholar, who really knows. Just, it does not require the biggest rabbi in the whole world. Just ask, mm-hmm. just like if something's wrong, physically, you'd go to a doctor. You wouldn't go to Haiti and go to a voodoo guy. You'd go to an MD, and you'd like the guy to have, graduated a fine school and has been practicing for a long time, and so. You do the same thing. If you got a question about why would a Jew hold a chicken over his head before Yom Kippur, ask. Because if the answer is not rich with meaning, then you're looking at nonsense. Mm-hmm. That's all.
Indeed. Okay, we're going to close with one final question. There's a guy who was trying to get a hold of us. I think he was out of the country. Robert Morley, who is following this video on YouTube. He says, when I am in a Jewish gathering, I am aware that I am being mistaken for a Jewish person by others. While I don't want to walk in, walk into a room and to make an announcement that I am not, I do let people, you know, appropriate what they think. Should I describe myself as a Noahide? Will the average Jew person understand the concept of Noahide, or am I better off just saying that I have come out of idolatry or Christianity? What's the best approach? I think that says, hold on, there's something else there. It says, I really hate even using the words like church and Christianity. I often say that I've come to the knowledge and love of Torah from outside the Jewish community. How would you, what kind of advice could you give this guy?
It depends on the circumstances. You know, the only time it would be important to point out that to the best of your knowledge, I'm not Jewish. And I use that kind of language because there are millions of Jews who think they're not Jewish today. And I encounter this every day. Is if you're in a synagogue and they have services and they're about to call you up to the Torah, which something only a Jew would make that blessing, or they're going to count you as part of a minyan, which means that you need 10 Jewish men in order to say certain prayers, or to read from the Torah. So then you say to the person who's running the service, I'm not Jewish, so I'm a Noachide, and I embrace, that would be the only circumstance where you would need to make that kind of an announcement, or you need to indicate to anyone. But I would certainly at some point, if you're to the best of your knowledge, you're not Jewish, and you find a synagogue that you enjoy the services and want to take classes and study, to go to the rabbi and of course introduce yourself. And we're big boys. Just say, I was a Christian. I've left Christianity. You don't need to make these statements about I found out Christianity is a big lie. The rabbi knows that, so you don't have to add that. Just say, I used to be Christian. I no longer am part of that, but I love the Jewish faith, and I just want to learn Torah and come to services. I would recommend not asking, can I come? Don't do that, okay?
Just show up.
That's the one thing Noachides do. Like, can I? Don't do it. Just go. Don't ask that question. Can I go? I don't know, because Rabbi might say, well, they may not be. They're just not oriented that way. That's it. But come, study Torah, and you're creating the image of God. So,
awesome, Rabbi. Thank you so much for your time, ladies and gentlemen. Join us next week again, same time, same place. For another episode number 23, Rabbi Toby Singer's Let's Get Biblical, question and answer. Go to the website, outreachjudaism.org, pick up the books, the CDs, the DVDs, lots of juicy stuff there. Shalom, shalom. Until next time, y'all have a great week. Shavuot Tov. ויתור זו הגדולה, השאיפה והכמיהה. מי אתה, תן תמיד תמיד כולם ביחד, חשוב מכל חשוב והכרחי להיות ביחד.